NFL Hall of Famer Lawrence Taylor is sentenced to 6 years probation. He did not speak as he came and went from court Tuesday. Taylor pled guilty to patronizing an underage prostitute. The girl was 16 at the time. She is now 17. She tried to give what's known as a victim impact statement before the judge. The judge refused, saying victims can speak only at felony sentencings. Taylor pled guilty to misdemeanors.
He could have faced years behind bars, but tonight, former football great Lawrence Taylor cutting a deal, and instead of prison, he's getting probation. And tonight, for the first time, the victim speaking out, and she is not happy.
Rashid ordered me to go there and have sex for money. When I refused, Rashid beat me. Rashid punched me in my face. He made my nose bleed and gave me a black eye. He hit me so hard, my eyes were swollen. He also stomped and kicked me. Then Rashid forced me to take off my blue jeans and put on a dress. He then made me get into his car and go to the hotel. I was very frightened and didn't know who I would meet in the hotel room or what person would be there. I mean, what person there would do to me. I never had sex for money. I never wanted to do it. When I entered the hotel room, my hair was in a ponytail and I had no makeup on. There was some light in the room and I believed that Mrs. Taylor could see my face and my swollen eye and how young I looked. I also told him that this was my first time and I was nervous and that I didn't feel comfortable, but all he said was relax. I did what he told me to do because I was afraid what would happen if I did not. I was afraid that I would be beaten again if I refused. I am glad that Mr. Taylor have been prosecuted, but I am upset that he will not have to go to jail for what he did to me. I would have been willing to testify at a trial. I did testify in front of the grand jury in this case. I think Mr. Taylor should have to go to jail for what he did to me. My life has changed because of him. He took something precious from me. Every day I look in the mirror and know that I am not the same. I am hurt and mentally very stressed because of this. It has been a nightmare that should never have happened to me and that should never happen to any other teenage girl. It would take me a very long time to recover from his crime against me, and I am not sure if I ever will. Finally, I just wanted to be known that I am not a prostitute. And it makes me sick that I have been labeled as one because of the decision to allow Mrs. Taylor to plead guilty to patronizing a prostitute. I am a victim and I am hurting. I do not think the sentence given to Mr. Taylor today was fair. I think he should have been sent to jail for what he did to me. I hope this does not happen to other young girls.
And then in swoops in the legal eagles, and all of a sudden her story changes as dollar signs materialize, and that's so sad.
The girl's attorney says she was a victim, not a prostitute, and that she wishes Taylor had received prison time. Attorney Gloria Allred would not say whether or not her client would be filing a civil suit against Taylor.
Today, Lawrence Taylor was sentenced by New York Supreme Court Justice Honorable William Kelly. Defendant Taylor, a former NFL Hall of Fame football player, had originally been indicted on charges of rape in the third degree, criminal sexual act in the third degree, sexual abuse in the third degree, endangering the welfare of a child, and patronizing a prostitute for acts the grand jury alleged that he committed against a 16-year-old victim on May 6, 2010 in New York. However, recently Mr. Taylor agreed to plead guilty to one count of patronizing a prostitute and one count of sexual misconduct. The sentence that he received for those crimes today was probation and a requirement that he register as a sex offender. There'll be another proceeding to determine the level of sex offender status. I am appalled by the charge of patronizing a prostitute to which he was permitted to plead guilty and also by the sentence that he received. My client, the 16-year-old victim, was not a prostitute when she met Mr. Taylor in the hotel room on May 6, 2010. She was instead a 16-year-old girl who refused to have sex for money.
Lawrence Taylor isn't here right now, but over the last 9 months, I've come to know him on a very personal level, and I can tell you one thing he does not want me to do is say anything in a negative way whatsoever about the young woman, Christina, who just appeared before you. It's interesting that Gloria, with all of her good works that she's done in the past, she's repeatedly using this word, she's a victim. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this young woman is being victimized once again. She really is. This was, what just took place was absolutely unnecessary. Nobody knew who she was. Everyone in the district attorney's office and on the defense team went to great lengths to protect her name, to protect her image, so she could go forth in life in this world of internet where everyone, things live on forever and ever, so that she could go on without this being a blemish on her record. But instead, an attorney who loves the cameras, who thinks, well, let me go sue Lawrence Taylor. You heard the no comments about the civil lawsuit. So let's see, it's 12:30. By 5 o'clock, you will hear about a civil lawsuit. It's just so sad that someone of the caliber of Gloria just stooped so low to possibly ruin the life once again of this young woman. Why? She's on television every day. She doesn't need to do this. Anyone who reads the newspaper knows Mr. Taylor is having some difficulties financially due to, if you read his custody proceedings. It's just, it saddens me as a lawyer that a fellow attorney who was sworn to do good and do the right thing just did what happened here. It's actually a disgrace. There are one or two things that were said that I need to, just to clear Lawrence's name. And what an insult to the district attorney, Mr. Zugibe, who's a fine district attorney, and his staff of Mr. Ferrara and Ms. Gunning. It is so disingenuous that they were not in constant contact with this young woman and our family. They were every step of the way, and before any plea agreement was reached here, it was with her approval. And well, whether somebody stands up here, a young, innocent girl stands up here reading a script written for her by a very well-known, very capable, very intelligent attorney who knows how to manipulate the press, maybe with the best of any of them, it's pathetic, and it's a sad day. That's a sad day for our justice system. It really is. Because before lawyers were involved, when it was just the young woman who on a document was just referred to as CF, because we all went to great lengths to keep her identity secret so this would not play a detrimental role in her life moving forward. Mr. Taylor, through the district attorney's office, offered to pay for any kind of therapy, any kind of schooling, any kind of rehabilitation she needed to help her. And instead, she gets caught up in the talons it really disturbs me as a member of the bar. My father is an attorney, and he raised me better than that. It's in limbo right now. The judge has a very, very big, busy calendar. He knows that there are real issues as to whether he falls in a level one or a level two. It's very clear to Mr. Taylor and myself and our defense team, when you read what the purpose of the Sex Offender Registry Act is, it's for that poor little girl, Megan Conker, who was 7 years old, who was raped and murdered by her neighbor across the street. So what the Sex Offender Registration Act is to do is that if somebody's living across the street that has a history of being a pedophile, of committing these types of sex acts, to let your neighbors know. It is absolutely inapplicable here. Did Mr. Taylor solicit a prostitute? Did he patronize a prostitute? Absolutely. Lisa Evers had to ask that question 15 times to get the truth. Yes, there was money exchanged willingly. We have witnesses, had we gone to trial, that said the young woman then enters a car jokingly saying, I got $300 and I didn't even have to have sex with him. We didn't want to go there. We didn't bring any of this up. None of this was public. I have an affidavit from our expert that before any lawyers were involved, this past July 19th, that during an interview, CF stated that during her meeting with Lawrence Taylor, he asked her how old she was, and she lied. She says she lied, and she said she was 19 years old. That during the interview, she stated that Mr. Taylor was not aggressive, nor was he forceful in his conduct, and he was respectful at all times. That at no time during that interview did she say anything derogatory or negative about Mr. Taylor. And finally, that the young woman known as CF made it very clear that she in no way wanted to get Mr. Taylor in trouble because of her dishonesty about to him about her age. And then in swoops in the legal eagles, and all of a sudden her story changes as dollar signs materialize, and that's so sad. I'm reading from an affidavit that will be submitted at the sex offender registration hearing, signed by our investigator, who met with her, said she was a young, lovely young woman who at that time appeared troubled. And the good news, Juliet, was that when we went and met her again in November, he said she was much better. She looked better, she appeared better, it seemed that maybe she got back on the right path. You know, when they say, Lisa Evers asked a very apropos question. How is she mixed up in Rashid Davis, who's running strip clubs and things like that? Because unfortunately, and these are just the facts, that was where she was spending time. Unfortunately, her and Rashid Davis were having fights, not over whether she was paying the rent, about whether she stole his ecstasy tabs from his top drawer and whether she stole his marijuana from his top drawer. That's unfortunately the type of person that we're talking about, that Mr. Taylor, again, offered the financial support to get her the therapy, the treatment, the schooling, or whatever it was that she needed. And we were told, no, thank you, she's going to settle it on by herself.
Arthur, when you had a chance to speak earlier in the courtroom, you made Mr. Taylor wanted to apologize to a lot of people, and you named his wife and his fans. You pointedly did not name CF, and I wonder why.
I thought we were going to go right into the sex offender registration portion of the hearing, and there's a lengthy part where I address her and address what happened to her and his sorrow. So I kind of didn't want to steal my own thunder, to be quite candid with you, and that will be addressed on the next date. Again, quoted in the New York Post, a very reputable newspaper, by CF, when she arrived at the hotel and suffered, quote, the lights were off and Taylor didn't see my face was bruised. The girl recounted. Lawrence asked me my age, and I told him I was 19. See, the New York Post on May 19th, 2 weeks after this took place, they got the truth. They had no ulterior motives of lawsuits and dollar signs. They got the truth. And she told the truth, not only to the New York Post on May 19th, but to Diego Rivera, our investigator, on July 19th. So isn't it mysterious? And again, I'm standing up, and it's odd for me. It's not natural to stand up for a district attorney's office. But since, I don't know if they're holding their own news conference or not. But for them to stand up here and say the DA's office wasn't concerned about what she wanted and what the outcome she wanted on this case is preposterous. It's ridiculous. Unless they stood up between myself, Mr. Taylor, and the judge and constantly lied. Because they constantly said, we need to check with the victim. We want to ask the victim. We want to make sure this is cleared with the victim. And in December, when they called with the plea offer, they said, we have checked with the victim. She's okay with this. The whole family's okay with this. So I apologize to everyone if my tone is a little stressed. It was very disturbing after having a very professional experience here in Rockland County for a very difficult case to then have this curveball and circus-like atmosphere thrown into something where it really doesn't shine brightly on our criminal justice system, that even though it's not perfect, is probably the best in the world.
Arthur, can you summarize the probation conditions?
Yeah, the probation conditions are, when he goes to Florida, he's going to sit down with a drug counselor and an alcohol counselor to make sure he doesn't need drug counseling and alcohol counseling. They want him in the house by 1 o'clock in the morning, which that's not going to be a problem because they want him until 5. So he wakes up to go golfing at 5 anyway. He's in bed by 10 o'clock. We're not worried about that. There were no probation conditions placed on Mr. Taylor that are going to have any material effect on his life whatsoever. We're very relieved and. Relieved that this is over, relieved with what happened today, and Mr. Taylor just wants to turn the next page in his life. He wants to go back out raising money for children. He'd love to do a little more television, go in another movie, He's got a little beautiful son he needs to support. He's got a wonderful supportive wife who's been with him, had his back from day one, and obviously was here again today. So life is moving on for Mr. Taylor in the most positive way possible. I'm not saying this. I'm telling you what we have a witness who's a, with sworn witness who says she leaves the hotel, comes out waving $300 in the air and says, I had $300 with him and I didn't even have to have sex with him.
But Mr. Taylor told the Round Park Police and the FBI, or Federal U.S. Department, U.S. Justice Department, that he did have sex with him.
Mr. Taylor never spoke to the U.S. Justice Department. He did not. If you read the statement, it does not say he had the common definition of sex with her. He had a different type of sex with
her.
We don't need, my mother's listening. Why you left? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, I just have a very brief reply to Mr. Aidala.
Aidala,
that too. A wonderful, prominent criminal defense attorney, and we understand he's vigorous in his representation of criminals. And, of course, now Mr. Lawrence Taylor is one of those criminals that he has represented and who now has a criminal record. Just very briefly, I know that he did a long song and dance, beautifully, about protecting the victim. Who is he protecting when he didn't want the victim to speak out? Is it really Mr. Taylor that he was protecting? And is that why he's so upset that the victim found her voice and did speak out with you today? She wanted her voice to be heard. The voice of criminal defense attorneys and defendants they represent, the criminals, are not the only voices that matter. And if she hadn't spoken out today, the truth would never have been known. Only their side of the so-called truth, their version, their spin would be known. And he quoted from a report by his own investigator, naturally. His investigator is going to give him the report that he wants to be able to use, that he thinks is going to paint his client in the light most favorable to his client. It was by his own investigator. Not a surprise. So finally, I'll just say, we are very happy that we came today. Thank you for listening to a victim, to a teenage victim. And if we hadn't come here today, you would have all left thinking that she was a prostitute. And now you know the truth, that a young woman who has been beaten and forced to go there and who has cried out for rescue in a text is a victim. And that is all that she is. And that is how she should be remembered. Thank you.
Taylor will be back in court on April 12th. At that time, a judge will decide to designate him either a level 1 or a level 2 sex offender. Level 2s have their picture in the Megan's Law database. Level 1s do not. Ted Chaffrey, Associated Press, New City, New York.